Hello everyone. Today I will be discussing on well control. Again, this is a very important topic and questions are being asked from this particular topic in GATE examination. So without further ado, let's get started with the presentation. I would be discussing these 5 points throughout my presentation, which is basics of well control, indications of kick. In indications of kick, I will be discussing early signs and positive signs of kick, influx types and behavior. Okay, if there is a oil kick or a gas kick, or let's say if I'm considering HPST condition, at that time how this influx type influence our well control. Okay, that we will be discussing that also. We will discuss well control equipments, and finally we will discuss well killing. In well killing, I will be discussing driller's method, weight and weight, volumetric and bullheading. Okay, so I would be discussing these contents which are relevant to GATE examination. Okay, this can be a very difficult topic if you are considering IWCF certification or IADC certification level of things. Then these things can be more complicated, but I will be discussing only relevant to GATE examination. All right, okay. Now coming to basics of well control. The definition: it is a technique used in oil and gas drilling to prevent the formation fluid to flow into the wellbore. Okay, this is the first point. And second point is to control the formation fluid if it starts to flow into the wellbore. Okay, as we all know, we are using drilling mud. We are using drilling mud to give hydrostatic pressure. Okay, to keep the hydrostatic pressure greater than my formation pressure. As we all know, the mud is used to maintain an overbalance condition. Okay, overbalance condition, that means with the help of mud I am trying to give mud hydrostatic pressure greater than the formation pressure. Okay, and the main reason behind giving this particular thing is that means I am preventing any sort of influx entering into the wellbore. Okay, if my influx gets into the wellbore, then it is termed as kick. Okay, that's the first point. And second point of well control is, if at all, first of all, I will try to prevent any sort of influx coming into the wellbore, okay, by keeping my mud hydrostatic pressure greater than the formation pressure. Let's say by any case or by any chance, the well fluid has entered, the unwanted fluids has entered into the wellbore. Okay, now if it has now entered into the wellbore, now with the help of well control, I will try to control the formation fluid. Okay, and I will safely try to remove that kick or the unwanted fluids out of my well. Okay, so these two things constitutes well control. Got it? Okay, now as I mentioned, overbalance condition is achieved when I keep my mud hydrostatic pressure greater than the formation pressure. Got it? And there is other case where underbalance condition is there, where my mud hydrostatic pressure goes below my formation pressure. Okay, now let's say my formation pressure is 5000 psi, and let's say my hydrostatic pressure because of mud is 5200 psi, then this condition is a overbalance condition where I am keeping the overbalance of 200 psi. Got it? Now let's say by some case my hydrostatic pressure of the mud goes below 5200. Okay, let's say if it goes below 4200, if it goes to till 4800 psi, at that time my well has gone underbalanced. Okay, it has gone underbalanced by 200 psi. Now at that time there are high chances that the well fluid, that the reservoir fluid, will try to enter into the well bore, which is not feasible for us. Okay, so that's well control for us. Now let's discuss kick. Now there is a confusion between kick versus blowout. Okay, so we will clear that confusion. Okay, now kick, it is defined as the influx or flow of formation fluid into the wellbore. Got it? Whatever unwanted fluids is coming into the wellbore, it can be termed as kick. Now when does this happen? This happens only when the formation fluid pressure exceeds the bottom hole pressure. See, I have discussed this thing over here. When my formation fluid pressure exceeds the bottom hole pressure, at that time the kick will enter into the wellbore. Okay, now let's take an example over here. let's say my well is completely filled with drilling mud. Okay, it is completely filled with drilling mud. Now my hydrostatic pressure, let's say over here, is 5000 psi and my formation pressure is, hydrostatic is 50 to 100 psi and formation pressure is 5000 psi. Okay, at this time there will be no kick entering into the wellbore, but let's say because of some reason, instead of 50 to 100 psi, my hydrostatic pressure has gone, has reached 4800 psi. Okay, at that time there will be influx. Okay, there will be, see, now the well has taken this influx. Okay, that means the well has taken this kick, well has taken this kick because I have lost my overbalance condition. Got it? So this is kick. Now, but now coming to blowout, when I am not able to control the kick, okay, and it has, the kick has gone uncontrollable, at that time we experience blowout. Okay, blowout is a very dangerous thing and it can lead to accidents and entire crew and entire drilling equipments will be under jeopardy when a blowout condition is occurred, when a blowout condition is experienced. Okay, so this is a very, this picture is of a deep water horizon. Okay, deep water horizons blowout, which unfortunately, it was a very unfortunate incident which occurred in the year of 2010. Now let's discuss types of well control. We have three types of well control, which is primary, secondary and tertiary well control. Okay, now primary, let's discuss primary well control. During the normal drilling operation, the pressure exerted by the hydrostatic column of the drilling fluid in wellbore is always kept slightly more than the formation fluid pressure. Okay, that means I am always trying to keep a overbalance condition. Okay, that means my mud, the mud hydrostatic itself will act as my primary well control agent. Okay, the use of mud hydrostatic to balance the formation fluid pressure is termed as primary well control. Got it? Okay, now coming to secondary well control. If due to any reason the hydrostatic pressure exerted by the drilling fluid column falls below the formation fluid pressure, the formation fluid starts entering into the wellbore, as I discussed earlier, when I am losing my overbalance condition, at that time the unwanted fluids from the reservoir will try to enter into my wellbore. Okay, now in that particular situation we say that my primary well control is lost. As we know, primary well control means whatever hydrostatic mud, whatever hydrostatic pressure I am getting with the help of mud, and whatever overbalance condition I am getting, that is my primary well control. When I have lost control over that, that means now we have to go for a secondary well control. Okay, now at that time BOPs is used in such situation to prevent further flow of formation fluid into wellbore. Okay, BOP means blowout preventer. We will be discussing in detail what does a BOP mean and what are the components of a BOP in well control equipment part. Okay, later the well is killed using well killing methods. Okay, once I go with the secondary well control, once I use BOPs to control further flow of influx into the wellbore, then I will go for well killing method. Again, we will be discussing well killing methods in detail. Okay, the main objective of a secondary well control is to restore the primary well control. Always my objective would be to restore primary well control. That means by having primary well control, at that time I can go for normal drilling operations. Okay, to go for normal drilling operations, I will always desire that my well have primary well control. Got it? Now, in case the overbalance is lost, the use of BOPs to prevent further flow of influx into the wellbore and restore primary well control is termed as secondary well control. Okay, just I have this is the summary of whatever I have discussed. Okay, my main aim of secondary well control is to restore back my primary well control so that I can continue my normal drilling operations. Got it? Okay, now let's discuss tertiary well control. Okay, now it includes techniques used to control the uncontrolled well when the primary and secondary control is lost. Let's say now primary well control is lost and even my secondary well control is lost. At that time I will go for a tertiary well control. Okay, now the objective of a tertiary well control is to establish secondary well control. ओके एंड सब्सिक्वेंटली प्राइमरी. ओके ऑब्जेक्टिव वुड बी पहले मेरा सेकेंडरी वेल कंट्रोल वापस आ जाए, उसके बाद एक बार सेकेंडरी वेल कंट्रोल वापस मिलने के बाद आई विल ट्राई टू एस्टेब्लिश माई प्राइमरी वेल कंट्रोल एंड वंस आई गॉट माई प्राइमरी वेल कंट्रोल बैक देन आई कैन गो फॉर नॉर्मल ड्रिलिंग ऑपरेशन. गॉट इट. नाउ अ रिस्टोरेशन ऑफ अ सेकेंडरी वेल कंट्रोल इंक्लूड्स एक्टिविटीज सच एज रीएस्टैब्लिशमेंट्स ऑफ बीओपीस और वेल हेड, रीएस्टैब्लिशमेंट्स ऑफ वेल बोर कंड्यूट एंड थर्ड इज ड्रिलिंग रिलीफ वेल्स. नाउ let's say due to some reason my BOP got damaged or my well head got damaged, at that time I have to go for tertiary well control and my very first action of plan would be to reestablish my BOP and well head so that I can have my secondary well control. Got it. Now second thing is, let's say by any chance my well bore conduit itself got damaged, at that time my plan of action would be to reestablish my well bore conduit. And let's say I am not able to have proper wellbore conduit or I have failed to re-establish my BOPs, then I have no other option but I have to go for a drilling of a relief well. Okay, drilling of a relief well. So what does a relief well means? Let's say there is a well over here. Okay, let's say there is a well over here. Okay, and now this particular well is flowing uncontrollably to the surface. This particular well is flowing uncontrollably to the surface, okay? Completely uncontrollably it is flowing to the surface. And I have failed to re-establish my BOP or well head, okay? Now at that time what I will do is that I will drill a well nearby to it, near to this point, okay? I will try to reach till this point. I will try to get my well till this well bore. And now from this well bore I will try to pump heavy kill mud. Okay, from this point I will try to establish back my primary well control. Got it. So this is how I establish. This is a drilling well. This is a relief well. And this is my original well bore where some blowout has occurred. Got it. So this is the concept of relief well. Now let's discuss hydrostatic pressure. Okay. As we all know, hydrostatic pressure is the pressure exerted by a static column of fluid, and it depends on the density of the fluid and it depends on the height of fluid column. Okay. As we all know, pressure is equal to rho gh. And now when we are talking in terms of drilling calculations, it would be 0.052 into mud weight into TVD, which is total vertical depth, and this mud weight would be in pound per gallon PPG, and this TVD, that is total vertical depth, would be in feet, between feet. Okay, now we will see how we obtain this 0.052, this conversion factor. Let's see how we obtain this 0.052. Got it. Now as we all know, my pressure in psi, and this pressure will be in psi. Okay, the pressure in psi is equal to some constant. This constant is 0.052 into pound per gallon into feet. Okay, now as we all know, 1 gallon equal to 231 inch cube, and we also know that 1 feet is equal to 12 inches. Once we have this, what we do is that we divide 231 over here and we multiply 12 inch, okay, so that I can get my answer in pound per inch square. So this is how I get 0.052. got it. Okay, let's discuss whether a shape of some container affects our rho gh. Okay, now let's say I am taking a container over here. Assume that this kind of a container, and the second container is of this shape, third container is of this particular shape, and fifth container is of this particular shape. Okay, but my vertical depth, or my total vertical depth, is, let's say, 10 feet. It is constant for all, 10 feet. This is also 10 feet. Over here also my total vertical depth is 10 feet. This is also 10 feet. Just assume, okay? And let's say I have filled fluid. I have filled fluids in all the three cases. I have filled fluids, and the density of the fluid is 8.33 density of the fluids that I've used to fill these four containers have density of 10 pound per gallon. Okay, let's say 10 pound per gallon. Now if I'm told to calculate what would be the pressure exerted at this deepest point, at the deepest point, then my pressure exerted would be, pressure is equal to 0.052 into mud weight into TVD. Okay, so that is 0.052 into, in this case it's 10 into 10. Okay, and my answer turns out to be 5.2 psi. From this thing we can conclude that my pressure which is been exerted at the bottom is independent of the shape of the container. Whatever container it is independent of the shape. Okay, that means my hydrostatic pressure is a property of density of the fluid column and the height of the fluid column. Got it? Okay. Now let's discuss when we have a vertical well, when we have a vertical well and a horizontal well. So let's see how things changes over there. Okay, let's assume that this is a vertical well with TVD of depth of let's say 1000 feet. Okay, let's say it is a TVD with 1000 feet. Okay, this is a vertical well. Now let me consider a horizontal well. I'm having an horizontal well. Okay, this is my horizontal well. Okay, assume that this is horizontal well, and again my TVD, in this case also my TVD is, ignore my diagram, sorry. Okay, this is my horizontal well, and in this case also my TVD is same. TVD is 1000 feet, but my total measured depth, that is my total drilling that I have taken, is measured depth is 4000 feet. Okay, that means I have drilled 4000 feet, but my TVD for this horizontal well is 1000 feet only. Okay, so in this case also, okay, as per the formula of hydrostatic pressure, we, even in horizontal well also, we don't have to consider measured depth, but we have to consider TVD only. Okay, true vertical depth is what we consider. So now if I'm told to calculate what would be my hydrostatic pressure in both the cases, in both horizontal as well as vertical well, my TVD will remain the same, which is 0.052 into, let me assume the mud weight I have used is 10 ppg. Okay, mud I am using in both the wells is of 10 ppg into 10 into, and my TVD is 1000. Now my answer would be 520 psi. Okay, 520 psi. So from this particular concept we can say that we always have to take TVD while calculating hydrostatic pressure. Okay, we, even for a horizontal well, we have to go for TVD and not the measured depth. Got it? Okay. Now let's discuss pressure gradient. Now as per definition, pressure per unit depth is considered to be pressure gradient. Okay, pressure per unit depth. Now as we all know, for fresh water, for water we know the density is 1000 kg per meter cube. It is also equal to 1 gram per centimeter cube. It's also equal to 8.33 pound per gallon. It will be also equal to 62.43 pound per feet cube. Okay, so this unit convergence is very important when we consider this unit convergence are very important. Okay, so take special note regarding this. Now let's say, now if I'm told to find out what would be my pressure gradient when I have a fresh water with density of 8.3 pound per gallon. Okay, now let's calculate it. As we all know, my pressure is 0.052 into my mud weight into TVD. Okay, now since we are told to find out the pressure gradient, my P by D equal to 0.052 into 8.33, that turns out to be 0.433 psi per feet. So we can say that for a fresh water case, my pressure gradient will be 0.433 psi per feet. Got it? Okay. Now let's calculate pressure gradient for salt water with 8.92 pound per gallon. Again, same process. My P by D will be 0.052 into mud weight, which is 0.052 into 8.92, which turns out to be 0.052 into 8.92, 0.463. 0.463 psi per feet. Okay, that means if I am having salt water with density of 8.92 pound per gal, at that time my pressure gradient will be 0.463 psi per feet. Okay, got it. It's a very simple concept. Now let's discuss bottom hole pressure, and this is a very, very important concept. We need to have a proper understanding regarding this bottom hole pressure. Okay, so now let's discuss this thing in detail. So as per the definition, my bottom hole pressure is the sum of all the pressures, whether it is static, dynamic and surface, being exerted at the bottom of the hole. Okay, that means in, let's consider this well, whatever my pressures are acting at this bottom part of the well, we need to take into account each and every component to calculate my bottom hole pressure. Okay, now bottom hole pressure equal to hydrostatic pressure plus or minus dynamic pressure plus surface pressure. Okay, so this is the definition of a bottom hole pressure. Now different type of dynamic pressure associated with the well are, so these are the different type of, there are three different types of dynamic pressure which is associated. That means I am talking about this particular component over here, this plus or minus dynamic pressure. So there are three main dynamic pressures that we encounter. First is when I am circulating, okay, when I am doing my normal drilling operations and my mud pump is working and I am circulating my drilling mud through my drill string, from the drill string through the annulus, when I am circulating my drill mud, at that time I will experience annular pressure losses. Okay, this annular pressure losses I experience. So this is this annular pressure loss is one kind of a dynamic pressure that we need to calculate while considering bottom hole pressure. So that's one thing. Second thing is while running in hole, okay, while running in hole, at that time also I will experience some sort of surging. Okay, this surging is experienced. That means when I'm running in hole, let's say this is my drill string, and when let's say I am running in hole, okay, I'm going down, back down, at that time I will experience some sort of a surging. Okay, so this surge pressure is also one kind of a dynamic pressure, and we, whenever we have surging, we will add that particular pressure to the bottom hole pressure. And third is during pull out of hole, when I am, let's say I have completed my drilling and now I want to change my bottom hole assembly of the well, of my drill string, at that time I have to pull out of the hole. See, I am pulling out of the hole. At that time I will experience some sort of swabbing or some sort of a suction pressure, which can lead to a negative pressure over there. Okay, so whenever we have swabbing, we will subtract that particular pressure with the hydrostatic pressure to get my bottom hole pressure. Okay, I will discuss all the three, which is annular pressure loss, surging and swabbing, in detail in coming up slides. Okay, let's discuss the bottom hole pressure during different well situations. Let's say I am not circulating, okay, I have stopped my pump and I am not pumping any sort of drilling mud through the system. That means I have whatever drilling mud is there in my well bore, I am considering that only. At that time, if I am told to calculate what is my bottom hole pressure, then my bottom hole pressure would be simply hydrostatic pressure of the mud column in the well. Okay, at that time I won't be having any sort of a dynamic pressure, nor I will be having any sort of a surface pressure. Got it? Okay, now second case is while drilling, when I'm told to calculate what are the what would be my bottom hole pressure during drilling, at that time I will say that my bottom hole pressure equal to hydrostatic pressure of the mud column in the well, and I will add the annular pressure losses. Okay, okay, now let's discuss annular pressure loss over here. So this is a well and I am circulating drill mud through this drill string, and from this is my bit, and from the bit through the nozzles of the bit, my drilling mud is going into the annulus of the well bore. Okay, so this is how the journey of the drilling mud will happen in the well bore. Okay, now at this time we can see that some sort of a friction, as we all know, friction acts in the opposite direction of the motion of a component. Okay. Now, since my drilling mud is going in the upward direction, since my drilling mud is going up, upward direction, that means there is some sort of a friction that acts in the downward direction. See, friction is acting in the downward direction. That means over here, when I am circulating my drilling mud, at that time, my friction, there will be two components of friction over here. One component, one friction would be the friction because of drilling, but the friction between drilling mud and the drill string, outer part of the drill string, that's one friction component. And the second friction component will be the friction between the drilling mud and the well bore itself. Okay, so there will be two friction component acting in the downward direction. Why downward direction? Because as per the definition of a friction, we know that friction will always act in the opposite direction of the motion of a component. Okay, so since my pressure is acting downward and also my hydrostatic pressure obviously will act downward direction. Okay, so I am adding this annular pressure losses whenever I am considering to calculate bottom hole pressure while drilling case. Okay, I think you got it. Now let's discuss this third component of our bottom hole pressure, which is the surface component. Now to calculate the surface pressure, so what is surface pressure? Let's see. It is any kind of a pressure added to the system from the surface. Okay, any kind of a pressure which is added to the system from the surface. For example, if you are using cementing unit or we are using some BOPs, or let's say I have shut the well, at that time I record SIDPP, that is shut in drill pipe pressure, and SICP, which is shut in casing pressure. So these all are the pressures that we account for when we have to when we have to calculate the surface pressure. Okay, now let's discuss this SIDPP. I will just discuss in basic in very basic way possible, because I will be discussing this SIDPP and SICP in detail in coming up slides. So let's say I have shut the well. At that time, whatever pressure I am recording at my drill pipe area, that would be my shut in drill pipe pressure. And whatever, and after shutting in the well, whatever pressure I am experiencing in the casing side, that would be or in the annular side, that would be my casing, shut in casing pressure. Okay, I will be discussing this SIDP and SICP in very much detail when we will discuss well killing. Now let's discuss while running in hole. See, this is the running while running in hole. That means this case, surging case, when I'm running in hole, at that time I have to add this surge pressure. Okay, because when I'm running in hole over here, so I will be compressing this particular layer, fluid column. Okay, when I'm running in very rapidly, when I'm running my drill string down, at that time whatever drilling fluid is in the bottom part, I will be compressing that particular column of mud. Okay, so because of this compression, I can give this surge pressure. Okay, and let's say if I am giving a lot amount, a high amount of surge pressure, then at that time sometime it may lead to fracturing of the of my layer, which can lead to fracturing of layer, and because of this fracture I can have some problems such as loss circulation also. So we need to avoid giving high amount of surge pressure to the wellbore. Okay, now second case is during pullout. See, this is my pullout, this is my pullout thing, that is I am experiencing swabbing. Okay, at that time what happens is that if I am trying to quickly remove the drill string out of the wellbore, at that time I may create some sort of a suction over here. I may create some sort of a suction at the bottom hole pressure. Okay, because of this suction, I have to subtract this swab pressure. I have to subtract this swab pressure from the bottom hole pressure formula. Okay, because a negative pressure we are giving. Okay, so this is how I calculate my bottom hole pressure when I have the case for a running in hole, that is surging, and second is when I have a case for pulling out of the hole, which is swabbing. I will be discussing again this surging and swabbing in detail, and what are the so-called parameters which affects surging and swabbing, I will be discussing in coming up slides. Now, when the well is shut in after the kick, okay, now let's say my well has taken the kick and I have gone for secondary well control, that is I have operated my blowout preventer, I have closed my BOPs. At that time, let's see what are all the at that time, if I'm told to calculate what will be my bottom hole pressure, now let's see what are the parameters that affects over there. So in that time, my bottom hole pressure in the drill string part, from the drill string part, if I'm calculating my bottom hole pressure, at that time my bottom hole pressure would be bottom hole pressure equal to hydrostatic pressure of the mud column in the drill string plus SIDPP. As I mentioned, once I shut the valve, whatever pressure I am recording over here is my SIDPP, and whatever pressure I am recording in the analyst side, that would be my certain casing pressure. So from the bottom, from the drill string, if I calculate bottom hole pressure, then that would be whatever hydrostatic pressure, that is whatever mud is present over here, hydrostatic column because of that, plus my SIDPP, which is the surface pressure that I am giving. So if I am adding that two components, then I will get my bottom hole pressure in the drill string part. Okay. Now, as I mentioned, the well has taken a kick. Okay. Now let me draw a kick over here. Let this be the kick. This yellow part is my kick, and this green part is my drilling mud. Now this green part is my drilling mud. Okay. Now if I'm told to calculate bottom hole pressure from the annulus side, at that time let's see how the formula of bottom hole pressure changes. So my bottom hole pressure would be hydrostatic pressure of the mud column in the annulus. See, the mud column, hydrostatic pressure of this mud column, plus the hydrostatic column of the kick column, plus this kick column. Okay, this is the kick column and this is the mud column, and plus SICP, which is the surface pressure. Okay, so it's very simple. If I'm told to calculate my bottom hole pressure at the time when I have shut in the well and I have recorded SICP and SIDPP, at that time my bottom hole pressure because of the well of the, so the bottom hole pressure in the annulus side would be the hydrostatic pressure of mud column plus the hydrostatic pressure of the kick column plus the SICP. Okay, so now let's discuss swabbing in detail. Now when the drill string is pulled out of the hole during a trip, okay, during a trip means I have completed my drilling part, and let's say now if I wanted to change my bottom hole assembly, if I wanted to replace my bit, at that time I have gone for some sort of I have gone for a pulling out of hole. Okay, so at that time whenever I am pulling out my drill string, at that time the mud must flow down past it to fill the space behind it. Okay, so at that time whenever I am pulling out the hole, so it is expected that my mud will flow past it. But sometimes what happens is that sometimes my mud cannot fill that particular empty space. So the effect of the bit and the bottom hole assembly can be compared with a loosely fitted plunger in a syringe. So this bottom hole assembly, let's say this bottom hole assembly can be considered as a plunger, and this well, our well, can be considered as a cylinder. Okay, and now let's say if I am quickly pulling this, and this is my string. Okay, now let's say if I am quickly pulling the string in the which has a plunger at the bottom, and this is my cylinder, at that time definitely I will be creating some sort of a suction pressure. Okay, some sort of a suction pressure I would be generating. So because of this suction pressure, I will be inviting new well fluids into the well bore, which is undesirable for us. Because of that my bottom hole pressure may reduce. So that's why we are subtracting the swab pressure. Bottom hole pressure is equal to hydrostatic pressure minus the swab pressure. So that's why we are subtracting that swab pressure, because of this negative suction we are giving. Now what are the factors which are encouraging swabbing? First is the pipe pulling speed. Okay, that means it takes more energy to move mud quickly. So the faster the string is moved, the greater the pressure drop would be. So it, let me discuss over here. Let's say this is my well bore and this is my drill string, this is the bit, this is my drill collar part, this is my drill collar, and this is my drill pipe. Let this be the drill collar, DCS drill collar, let this be the DPS drill pipe, and let this be bit. Okay, so this is the case. Now so pipes pulling speed, that means it takes more energy to move mud quickly. So the faster the string is moved, the greater the pressure drop would be. Second is small hole clearance or slim hole geometry. So it takes more energy to move the same volume of mud through smaller space. So the less the annular space available, the greater the pressure drop would be. So as we can see that in this particular portion, in this particular portion, my annular space is also less as compared to this portion. As compared to this portion, that is the annulus of drill pipe and my well bore. And now if I'm comparing the annular space with that to the annular space of bottom hole assembly and the well bore at that portion also, you can see that here the annular clearance is very less. Okay, that means more energy it will take for the same volume of mud to occupy in that particular smaller space. So smaller the hole clearance, that means more would be my swabbing process. Now third is high mud viscosity. Now evidently it takes more energy to move a thick mud than the thin one. Hence more the viscous the mud, the greater the pressure drop would be. Obvious, again it is a very obvious thing. The higher the viscosity or higher the gel strength of the mud, more time it will take for the mud to fill the space behind it and more would be the pressure drop. Got it? Now let's discuss swabbing, let's discuss surging. So again we know my surging, if I want to calculate surging would be hydrostatic pressure plus my surge pressure. We are adding surge pressure. So let's look at the theory. When the pipe moves downwards with the mud circulation through the drill string, additional bottom hole pressure called surge pressure is created. Now if surge pressure is too much, then problems such as formation breakdown, partial mud loss or loss circulation can occur. Okay, because let's say my surge pressure is too high that my total bottom hole pressure has exceeded the formation fracture pressure, then it may lead to formation breakdown, which can further lead to partial loss of the mud or may lead to loss circulation. Okay, again this surge pressure adds to the bottom hole pressure. Because of surging, what happens is that whatever mud is present at the bottom of the bottom part of the drill string, I am trying to compress it. Okay, by quickly running in the hole, I am trying to compress that particular column of fluid which is beneath my drill string. So because of that, we are adding the surge pressure to the bottom hole pressure. Okay, got it. Now again as I have discussed annular pressure, let me again go through it. When the drilling fluid travels up the annulus, okay, at that time a downward friction force acts between drilling fluid and the wall of the well bore. Again this downward friction will act because of drilling fluid and the wall of the well bore. And second is drilling fluid and the outer wall of the drill string. See this part. And it acts downward direction because friction acts in the opposite direction of the flow of a component. So this is the formula which can be used to calculate the pressure loss, annular pressure loss. Okay, it's a very important formula. And pressure is in psi, mud weight is in pound per gallon, my length of the annulus is in feet, my velocity, that is annular velocity, is in feet per minute, my hole diameter is in inches, my drill pipe or OD, my drill pipe outer diameter is also in inches. So this is the very important formula where, with the help of which we can calculate the annular pressure losses. Okay, now coming to ECD. So this ECD or equivalent circulation density will occur when my normal drilling operations are carrying out. That means whenever my pumps are on and my drilling mud is flowing from the drill string via the annulus and coming up, at that time I will be getting this equivalent circulation density. And this equivalent circulation density is the property is because of my annular pressure loss. Okay, so ECD or equivalent circulation density is the effective density that combines current mud density and the annular pressure drop. Okay, so this is the formula of ECD, where this is the current mud weight or the original mud weight that I am obtaining, original mud weight, and I'm getting an additional component because of APL, annular pressure loss. Again, APL is acting in the downward direction. That's why we are adding it to the ECD. So let me discuss a case over here. Let's say case one, where my mud pumps are off. My pumps are off. At that time, if I am told to calculate ECD, then I won't get any ECD. At that time, we will be getting my original mud only original mud weight only. Okay. Now in case two, let's say now I am my pumps are on. At that time only I will get the ECD because my pumps are on, my annular pressure loss will be acting. So my ECD will be original mud weight or the current mud weight plus APL plus this term APL divided by 0.052 into TVD. So I will get the ECD over here. Got it? Okay. Now let's discuss formation pressure. As we all know, formation pressure is the pressure of the fluid trapped in the pores of the formation. Okay. So this diagram indicates, see, this is the diagram where there are no pore spaces, when there are unconnected pore spaces, and where there are connected pore spaces. Okay, in unconnected pore spaces, my fluid will always remain trapped. See, and in my connected pore spaces, there is connection, there is permeability, permeability where my flow, that where my fluid can flow. There is a passage for the fluid flow. Okay. So this passage for fluid flow will be there when I have a connected pore space, or when my porous media is permeable. Okay. Now the formation pressure can be of three types: normal, abnormal, and subnormal. Okay. Now coming to normal formation pressure, let's look at the theory. As the rock layers are deposited one upon the other, the formation fluid is squeezed out of the pores due to the overburden. Because of the overburden and because of my permeable porous media, whatever fluid is there, it is getting squeezed out once the layer of deposition occurs. But as long as the formation fluid is able to escape from the pores, the formation pressure bleeds down the normal value. Okay. As long as this particular fluid is getting this chance to escape from the pores, I am getting my normal value of formation pressure. And the accepted normal value of this particular formation pressure is 0.433 psi per feet to 0.465 psi per feet. Okay, this is the pressure gradient of normal pressure when we have a normal formation pressure. Okay, this is a very important term. We need to remember this range, that is 0.433 to 0.465 psi per feet. Now let's discuss for abnormal formation pressure. For abnormal formation pressure, if the formation pressure gradient is more than 0.465, at that time I would be experiencing this abnormal formation pressure. That means during the deposition, if my rate of deposition of layers is very rapid, and at that time I am not given enough time for the formation fluid to escape from the pores, and because of that phenomena, my pressure gets trapped, and because of that abnormal pressure is experienced. And if my pressure gradient is greater than 0.465, then we can term that as abnormal pressure gradient. Now let's look at subnormal pressure gradient. This is subnormal pressure gradient, sorry. Okay. Now if the formation pressure is less than the 0.433 psi per feet, at that time my formation pressure is considered to be subnormal. Okay. Now this is again the same thing only. If my formation pressure gradient lies between 0.433 and 0.465, it is normal pressure gradient. And if it lies above 0.465, it is abnormal pressure gradient. And if it lies below the 0.433 psi per feet gradient, then it is subnormal formation pressure. Okay. Now let's discuss what are some of the causes for abnormal formation pressures. So we have six reasons for it: under compaction, artesian effect, faulting, salt domes, gas cap, and charged sand effect. Okay. So we will be discussing these six things in detail. Now coming to under compaction. Now if the rate of deposition is low and gradual, then excess of trapped formation water is squeezed out in this process, resulting into full compaction. Okay. When my rate of deposition is low and I am giving enough time for my formation, trapped formation fluid to escape from the porous media, then at that time my compaction would be normal. That means my compaction would be will be in normal formation pressure gradient. Okay, but if my rate of deposition is very high and I'm not giving enough time for my trapped formation fluids to escape, then it can lead to formation water not escaping, and it can lead to abnormal or increased pressure gradient. Okay, so this pressure trap formation will then support the overburden and shall have abnormal pressure. Okay, this is very simple concept. Now let's discuss this particular case of artesian effect. Okay, now to discuss this effect, let's say this is my source. Let's say I have drilled till this point. I have drilled this till this depth of 2000. This is 2000 feet. And I have done my drilling till this point. And there is this layer. There is this layer which is continuously charged, or which is having some source of source up there. Assume this is a mountain range. Okay, let's say this is a mountain range. And I am getting some, and there is this water layer. Okay, there is this sand, or there is this layer which is continuously charged by water, and this I am getting this source of water, let's say from rain or some water body up there. Okay, that means this layer is continuously charged. If I have to find what would be the pressure being experienced at this particular depth, so what would be my formula? It would be 0.052 into 2000 into, let's say I am using Now let's see if I have to find into depth. Into 8.33. So it turns out to be around 866 psi. But we have not considered this particular region also because as I mentioned, my source of water is at the top. Okay, that means I am getting the head. My hydrostatic head will be beginning from this particular depth. Okay, so this calculation is wrong. This is a wrong calculation. Now we have to consider this artesian effect also. Now if I am considering this artesian effect, now my pressure or the my formation pressure which will be acting in this particular point would be 0.052 into 4000 into 8.33. So this is my formation pressure that will be I would be experiencing in this particular depth. That would be 4000 into 8.33, 1732. So this is the formation pressure that will be experiencing over here. Now, if I am designing a mud for drilling this particular case, if I am designing a mud to drill this particular case at that time, my mud density should be, my mud weight should be 1732 divided by 0.052 into 2000. So my designed mud weight would be 1732 divided by 0.052 divided by 2000, which is 16 ppg. Okay, got it. So now if I'm drilling through this particular zone at that time, because of the artesian effect, my mud weight of the drilling mud that I should use while drilling this particular zone should be 16 ppg, close to 16.6 ppg, 16.6 ppg. Okay, got it. Okay, now let's move to faulting. Third case is faulting. Now let's say the layer, initially there was layer A. Okay, layer A, there was initially layer A. Now because of faulting, my layer got broke, my layer got fractured, and it has moved up over here and layer B. Now let's say if I'm drilling this particular zone, okay, now at that time I will get, and let's say my pressure gradient is 0.465 for this normal region. Okay, now if I'm going to calculate what would be my formation pressure experience, at that time I will multiply my pressure gradient with the depth of 3000. So my answer turns out to be 1395 psi. Okay, now let's say if I am planning to drill a well in this particular region, in the right side of my fault. Now in that point, if I am told to calculate what would be my formation pressure, okay, now to get that, I will not experience 0.465 gradient psi per foot. This is wrong. Now for this particular zone, my new formation gradient would be 1395 divided by 2000, because my depth has now reduced. So 0.697, this is my new gradient obtained. Okay, now if I am drilling through this particular gradient, if I am drilling to this particular gradient and I am told to find out what would be my hydrostatic pressure, okay, this is my new formation gradient. So from that we can get my formation pressure as 0.697 into 2000, which is 1395 psi. And if I am told to calculate what would be my mud weight at this particular depth, that is, if I am told to calculate what would be the mud weight while I am drilling this particular zone, so to calculate that, my mud weight will be equal to 1395 divided by 0.052 into depth of 2000. So that would be 1395 divided by 2000 divided by 0.052. It is 13.4 gallon. Okay, so this is how you calculate new mud weight if I am having some sort of faulting in my region. Okay, so because of this faulting, I have experienced some abnormal pressure. So to address that abnormal pressure, we need increased mud weight. Let's discuss gas cap effect. Again, this is a very important question for GATE. Now let's look at the diagram over here. So okay, this is the well I am planning to drill, and my top of the gas cap, my depth is given as, my TVD is given as 4800 TVD, and my thickness of gas cap is given as 950 feet. Okay, and my bottom of gas cap is 5750 feet. Okay, my pressure, normal pressure gradient is 0.52 psi per foot. Got it? Okay. Now if I am told to calculate what would be my new mud weight that I have to take into consideration when I am drilling through this particular zone, what would be my new mud weight? If I am told to calculate this particular thing, let's see how the thing works over here. So what would be, now if you have to calculate what would be my formation pressure at the rate gas cap, so to calculate that, first we need to take into account the depth. So it would be 4800 plus 950, 5750. Okay, so 5750 into my normal pressure gradient, which is 0.52 to 0.52 psi per feet, minus, we need to now subtract my thickness of gas cap. So that would be 950 into the gradient of gas pressure, gas gradient, that is 0.1 psi per feet. Now 2895 psi. Okay, this is my formation pressure experience. Now using this formation pressure, I can calculate my bottom hole I can calculate my mud weight. So my mud weight would be 2895 psi divided by 0.052 into the depth till the top of the gas cap. So that would be 4800 TVD. Okay, again you have to consider TVD only, not the measured depth. We always have to consider TVD. So that would be 2895 divided by 0.052 into 4800 100. So my answer is 11.6 pound per gallon. So this is the mud weight that I will take into consideration when I am drilling through this gas cap. Okay, and because of this gas cap, what happens is that my sort of a abnormal pressure is experienced. To mitigate that abnormal pressure, if I have already know I have gas cap, I will calculate my mud pressure, mud weight, or I will take my system mud weight as 11.6 ppg so that I can successfully drill through this gas cap. Got it? Okay. Now coming to next part, which is charged sands. Now let's see that this is a producer well. Okay, let's say this is a producer well, and this is another layer zone above it. Okay, I am drilling a well through this particular layer. Let's say this is layer A and this is layer B. My producer well is completed in layer B. Now due to some reason, there is a leakage in the casing of my producer well, and because of that leakage, my fluid from layer 3, that is my pressurized fluid from layer 3, has started entering this layer B. Okay, from this layer B, my pressurized fluids has started entering into layer A because there was some sort of leakage in my casing of a producer well. Okay, now because of that, what happens is that it has started to charge up this particular layer. Okay, so because of this charging, I can get an abnormal pressure being experienced. Okay, so this is the concept of charged sand. So whenever we have charged sand, we need to calculate what would be the new mud weight that we should take into consideration when drilling through that particular layer, if at all that particular layer is being charged by some layer beneath it. Got it? Okay, now coming to salt domes. Again, these salt domes can also lead to abnormal pressures. Okay, generally this salt diapirs or salt domes occurs because of stress changes, and these salt domes can lead to instability of well, can lead to well collapse, and even due to casing collapse. Okay, so if we are having some sort of salt domes, we are expected to have some sort of abnormal pressure. Got it? And generally we do not drill through salt domes, because if I am drilling through this salt dome, there are chances that the salt can get dissolved and can lead to abnormal pressure entering into the wellbore. So that's why whenever we have some salt dome in the field, so at that time we go for a directional well. Instead of vertically going through the salt, we go directionally and we try to avoid that particular salt diapir or salt dome. Okay, causes of reduction in hydrostatic head. Okay, this is also an important concept. So when does my hydrostatic head get reduced? Okay, so there are three main reasons. First is failure to fill the hole. Second is if there is some sort of water dilution at the surface. And third is removal of parts of barite from mud by solid control system. Now let's discuss failure to fill a hole. Okay, now as we all know, when the drill string is pulled out of the hole, at that time the mud volume decreases by the volume equivalent to steel volume of the drill string pulled out. Okay, when I'm pulling out some drill string out of the wellbore, out of a filled wellbore, okay, the wellbore which is filled by mud, if I'm pulling out that particular drill string, at that time we all know that whatever volume associated with the metal volume, the mud will come out of the wellbore. Okay, now whatever mud is coming out of the wellbore, now it becomes a responsibility to fill back that particular volume. Okay, so there would be trip tank in my drill site, and which will be attached to a motor, and we would be pumping drill mud continuously. Whatever volume has been pulled out of the hole, we will be continuously filling the hole with the help of trip tank. Okay, the volume of mud equivalent to the steel is to be filled out in the hole. So there is trip tank over here which does this thing of filling of the hole. If the hole is not filled at regular intervals, the level of liquid column in the wellbore reduces, and thus reduces the hydrostatic pressure. Okay, it's very important. If I'm not filling the hole at regular intervals, then this can lead to my hydrostatic pressure going below my formation pressure, and the chances the well may take kick. Okay, now The same thing, if the hydrostatic pressure falls below the formation pressure, heat may enter into the wellbore. Okay, so that's point one. Now, this second point, water dilution at the surface. Then sometimes what happens is that while cleaning the drill floor, at that time we use hoses to clean the drill floor. We use the water from the hose to clean the drill floor. At that time, this water can sometimes dilute the drill mud in the wellbore. So that's second point. Third point is removal of barytes, parts of baryte. As we all know, baryte is a weighing agent that we use in drilling mud. Okay. Now, if my solid control system, like there are desanders, desilters, centrifuge, etc. If my solid removal systems, if it is removing more amount of baryte, then this can lead to my mud being lighter in nature. Okay, this may lead to reduction of density in my mud. And because of this density reduction, my hydrostatic pressure can also reduce. Okay, so this is the third point of reduction in hydrostatic. Now, as I mentioned, if I am pulling out my drill pipe out of the hole, at that time I have to fill back the corresponding volume. Okay, now there are two types of pullout that occurs. One is a dry pullout and second is a wet pullout. Okay, I will discuss both of them in detail. Now, coming to dry pullout, while pulling out dry, we only need to consider the volume of steel. Okay, volume corresponding to the steel only needs to be considered while pulling out dry pipe. Okay, now, so this is the step one. Now, if I'm told what would be the hydrostatic pressure decrease, so this would be the step one to calculate that my total pipe volume is a barrel of length pulled out into pipe displacement. Okay, now if we need to consider what is my corresponding hydrostatic pressure decrease because of that particular volume being pulled out, so that so this formula will give my decrease in hydrostatic pressure. Okay, so this is a numerical or example given over here. So let's calculate what will be the hydrostatic pressure decrease. So I have 10 number of strands been pulled out. My pipe displacement is 0.05 barrel per feet. Average length per strand is 91 feet. Okay, 91 feet means I have connected 3 drill pipes. My one strand is equal to 3 drill pipe. Basically, this means that 3 drill pipe constitutes my one strand. My casing capacity is 0.083 barrel per feet and mud weight is 12 pound per gallon. Okay, now in this case, if I am going for a dry pullout and if I am told to calculate what would be my decrease in hydrostatic pressure, let's calculate it. Now again, step one would be to calculate what will be the pipe volume. Okay, now the pipe volume equal to, as we all know, what is the length of pipe being pulled out. I have pulled out 10 strands and my average length per strand is 91. Okay, and what is my pipe displacement is 0.005 barrel per feet. So this turns out to be 10 into 91 into 0.0055. It's 5.05. So my answer is 5.005 barrels of volume will be lost because of my dry pullout. Now, when I am dry pulling out and when I am experiencing my 5.005 barrels being lost, let's determine what would be my corresponding hydrostatic pressure decrease because of that loss of pipe volume. So the second step would be to calculate the hydrostatic pressure loss. So to calculate that, we know the total pipe volume. The total pipe volume was this 5.005. This is in barrel into 0.052 into mud weight. Mud weight is given as 12 pound per gallon. 12 pound per gallon. Divided by casing capacity. The casing capacity is 0.0873 barrel per feet minus my pipe displacement. Pipe displacement is again 0.005 barrel per feet. Now, do we have to do any sort of unit conversion? Let's see. Pound, barrel gets cancelled. So this feet will come up. This feed will come in the numerator. Okay, we don't need any sort of unit conversion. So my answer would be
5.005 into 0.052 into 12 divided by 0.0873 minus 0.0055. So my final answer is 38.2 psi would be my corresponding hydrostatic pressure loss when I'm going for a dry pullout. Okay. So this was all about dry pullout. And let's see if I am going for a wet pullout. Now let's say because of some reason, my bit nozzle got choked. Okay, there is choking in my bit nozzle. As a result, now if I am going for a pullout, in that particular case, my pipe volume, whatever volume in the pipe is there, we need to consider that also while going for a wet pipe pullout. Okay, so we need to consider the volume of steel out of the hole again, as similar to drill pipe, as similar to dry pullout. Plus, we also need to calculate what is the volume of mud in the drill pipe as well. Okay, now in this case, therefore, the pulling wet will decrease hydrostatic more as compared to dry pipe. Okay, because in this case, I am considering my total volume to be my volume of pipe, volume of steel plus volume of mud present in my drill pipe also. Okay, or my drill string. Okay, now to calculate what will be the hydrostatic pressure decrease, for that we have this formula. Again, for step 1, we need to calculate what is the barrels been displaced. So this would be my formula for barrels displaced. And for step 2 would be to calculate the hydrostatic pressure. So let's get started with this particular numerical. Okay. So we need to determine the hydrostatic pressure decrease when we are going for a wet pipe pullout. So percentage. So this is the given data. Percentage of volume in the drill pipe out of the hole is 100. Number of stands is 10, pipe displacement 0.05, average length given, pipe capacity given, mud weight given, casing capacity given. All right, it's a very simple numerical again. Let's see how to solve. First, we need to find out what is my barrels displaced. For finding the barrels displaced, so I have my length of stand given as 91 into my total stands, which is 10. Okay, we have that. Now we need my pipe displacement, that is because of my metal, 0.005 barrel per feet we have. Now since we need to also consider the pipe capacity also. Okay, metal displacement we have already considered. Now we have to consider what is the volume of mud in the drill pipe also. For that we have been given the pipe capacity. So we need to add the pipe capacity also. Now in this case, my barrels displaced, let's calculate my barrels displaced, that is 0.055 plus 0.01876 into 91 into 10. So my total barrels being displaced is 22.1 barrels. This is my total barrels being displaced. Okay. Now let's calculate the associated hydrostatic pressure loss. So for that, let's calculate. So we have my barrels displaced, which is 22.1 barrel into 0.052 into my mud weight, which is given as 12. Okay. Divided by, we know that my casing capacity is again 0.0873, which is given already, minus. Now the catch is, now we have to add both pipe capacity as well as pipe displacement, which is 0.01876 plus my pipe displacement, that is 0.0055. Once this, now let's see what would be my hydrostatic pressure loss corresponding to it. So it would be 218.52. It would be 218.52 psi. So this would be my pressure loss associated when I am going for a wet displacement. So as we can see, my total hydrostatic pressure loss in my wet pipe pullout is more. It's around 218.52. Okay, but when we were discussing of dry pullout, at that time my hydrostatic pressure decrease was around 38 psi. But in this case, it is 218, which is way more. All right. So that's the thing I want to prove, that whenever we are having wet displacement, my hydrostatic pressure loss would be more. At that time, we need to take special care that I always try to fill my wellbore. Okay, from the trip tank, I always fill my wellbore till the surface so that I get enough hydrostatic pressure, and I also have my overbalance condition. If my well goes under balance, then at that time the kick will enter into the wellbore and it can lead to damage. Okay, so that's that case of wet pullout and dry pullout. Again, important point, wet pullout, when we have to go for wet pullout, when my bit nozzles got choke because of some reason, my bit nozzle got choke, at that time only we need to take into consideration wet pullout. Okay, done. Now let's discuss YouTube effect. Okay, so as we know, this is my wellbore schematic, where this is my drill string, and this is my annulus of my wellbore and the drill string. So there are two sides basically. There is drill pipe side and there is casing side. Now this drill pipe side and the casing side can be denoted by a U-tube. See, we can denote it by U-tube, where my left hand arm of the U-tube can be denoted as drill pipe pressure side, and my right side arm of my U-tube can be denoted as casing pressure side, and there will be always a balance between both. That means I can find my bottom hole pressure at this bottom part, because both of them are, since it is a U-tube, both of them will try to balance out to give us a unique or a singular bottom hole pressure. So the pressure found at the base of the both the columns is considered to be bottom hole pressure. Got it? So whenever we are calculating U-tube, whenever we have to calculate bottom hole pressure, at that time we go for a U-tube effect. I have examples to prove this thing. So as of now, we have to understand this only. In further slides, we will be seeing what does this U-tube effect really mean and how does it affects our calculations. Now, there's another term, which is leak-off test and FIT, formation integrity test. Okay, so let's see leak-off test. So LOT or leak-off test is conducted to determine the minimum pressure at which the formation begins to leak. Okay, or in other terms, we can say that when my formation begins to fracture, at that point, at that pressure is the leak-off pressure. Okay, now that this test is conducted after drilling 10 to 15 feet of new hole. Okay, whenever let's say I have cased my entire, I have cased my particular zone, and after casing, what I did is I drilled 10 to 15 feet of my new hole, and at that point I will go for leak off test. Okay, so that I can get my form, what will be the fracture pressure, because what, let's say this wellbore that I have already drilled and I also cemented till the surface. I have cemented till the surface, and after that I took a new bit, a new smaller bit, and I drilled 10 to 15 feet, okay, of new hole. Now, as we all know, as I am drilling deeper, I will be going with a mud with density more than the initial mud weight. Okay, now if I am using that particular new drill mud with higher density, then I need to find what would be in the range. Okay, that means by using that new mud weight, so till what depth we can go. Okay, now to calculate that, we need to understand what would be the fracture pressure at this point, that is, what would be the fracture pressure at this particular casing sitting depth, because the casing sitting depth will be my least competent layer. Casing sitting depth, whatever fracture pressure would be there, that would be very crucial for determining what would be the density of my new mud and till what depth I can drill by using that new mud. Okay, So we are conducting this LOT or leak off test to get my fracture pressure at my casing sitting depth. So, and it is generally carried out, LOT test is generally carried out in exploratory wells, and it is carried out with a cementing unit, not a mud pump, because discharge pressure for a mud pump is very high. Okay, now coming to FIT or formation integrity test, these FITs are generally carried out in development wells. As we all know, development wells means the wells which are drilled in a developed reservoir. Developed reservoir means I know all the properties of the reservoir, I know the reservoir pressure, I know the depth, I know the contacts of my gas oil or oil water contacts, everything I know the boundary condition and each and everything. For that particular developed reservoir, if I am drilling wells over there, and that time we will be undergoing formation integrity test and not LOT. LOT test is generally carried out in exploratory wells only. Okay. Now to test if the formation, FIT means to test if the formation is holding necessary pressure or not, and it can be done with a mud pump. Okay. Now let's see LOT in more detail. So this is my process of LOT. So I have drilled to the total depth. I have pulled out my drill string, and after that I ran my casing. I cemented my casing. Then I run in. I now using smaller bit. I run in again, and I drilled out my bottom part of casing. Drill shoe, and I've drilled the drill shoe. I have drilled the shoe, and I drilled some 10-15 feet of new formation. I circulated this new formation to hole clean and displace with required mud weight for LOT. Okay. Now by using new mud weight, I circulated my whatever cuttings are there. I circulated it, and by using this new mud weight only, I circulated these cuttings out to the surface. And by using the cementing unit, I started pressurizing the system, and I got this particular trend. Okay, now what I did this by using cementing unit, I pressurized it, and I pressurized it till I got my leak off pressure. That means till the pressure at this point, from this point, my formation has begun to leak. Okay, see, there is a drastic change in the slope. Okay, this change in slope is because at this point, means after I started pressurizing, after some point of pressure being given, my fracture has begin, my formation has begin to leak. So this leaking is established because of this change in slope of pressure versus volume pump, and this point is my leak off test point. Okay, leak off pressure point. Okay, now to get FIT test, that is formation integrity test. So I won't be conducting formation integrity test till the leak off point. I will be just getting my FIT done till this point only. Okay, till my pressure gets slightly fluctuated, till that point only I will be conducting my FIT. And for LOT, I will conduct till my formation gets fractured to some extent, that, or in other case, my formation starts leaking. Till that point, I will conduct LOP or leak off test. And if I conduct it further, I will get my flow, what is formation breakdown pressure, and I can get my fracture propagation pressure, and I get an instantaneous shut in pressure. These things I will be discussing when I discuss hydraulic fracturing. Okay, in my hydraulic fracturing, I will be conducting this test till FVP and till ISIP. Okay. As of now, for drilling, we will consider this test till LOP point only. Okay, done. Now, other point that we need to consider is this calculation of maximum allowable annular surface pressure loss. Okay, now, what does this mean? It is the maximum annular surface pressure which can be applied above the hydrostatic pressure of mud column before the shoe gets fractured. Okay, as we all know, I got my fracture pressure of the shoe by LOT test. I have some sort of pressure. Okay. Once I have that pressure of what is formation fracture pressure. Now, what is the maximum annular surface pressure that I can apply? Okay. So that is my MASP. Now mass is the minimum of maximum surface pressure that is the casing or the wallet will hold. That's point one. And maximum surface pressure that the shoe will hold. Again, as I mentioned, my casing shoe, whatever casing sitting depth is there, that would be my least competent layer, and it would be more vulnerable to getting fractured. So again, MASP is the minimum of the maximum surface pressure that my casing can hold. Second point is the maximum surface pressure that the shoe will hold. Okay. Now during LOT or leak off test, my MASP is equal to the surface leak off test pressure for the fluid density. Again, obvious. Now if I am told to calculate, this is the formula of MASP. MASP again, MASP will change with change in mud density. Okay, as we all know, as I am drilling deeper, I will change my mud. Okay. Now whenever I am changing my mud, for each and every mud change, my MASP will also change. So MASP, the formula of MASP will be this. MASP is equal to leak off pressure into current mud weight into 0.052 into casing sitting depth. Okay, so this is my formula of MASP. Got it? Again, leak off test pressure mud weight, whatever the mud weight I used for leak off test pressure, minus the current mud weight, multiply by 0.05 is the conversion factor, and into casing sitting depth. Again, casing sitting depth, the true vertical depth is considered, not the measured depth. The true vertical depth till the casing sitting point. Okay, so that's how we calculate my maximum allowable annular pressure, annular surface pressure, which is MASP.
Applications of kick. Now, causes of kick can be any factors which lead to the hydrostatic pressure to fall below the formation pressure. All right, that means any reason because of which my well has gone under balance, then those reasons may be my potential causes for kick. Okay, now let's see what are all those. Improper hole fill up during trips. Again, we have seen this particular point when we were discussing wet pull and dry pull. Swabbing. Okay, because of swabbing, suction pressure is created. So as a result, this may lead to kick. Surging. Okay, because of surging, as I mentioned, because of surging, sometime what happens if I'm giving a large amount of surge pressure, then this can lead to formation breakdown. And because of this formation breakdown, it may lead to partial losses or total loss circulation. Okay. Abnormal formation pressure. Again, we have discussed it in very much detail. What are the reasons for abnormal formation pressure? Insufficient mud density. Okay. Sometimes what happens, let's say sometimes because of dilution of my mud, I am not able to give sufficient amount of mud density. So this can lead to decrease in hydrostatic pressure. Or let's say if my solid control equipments is removing more amount of barite from it, more amount of weighing agents has been removed by those components, then that can also lead to hydrostatic pressure going down. Okay. Next point is loss circulation. Okay, loss circulation can also lead to kick. Last point is gas cut mud. Okay, my gas is entering into the wellbore. At that time, what happens is because of gas being lighter in nature, it tries to reduce the hydrostatic columns density. Okay. So because of that, my hydrostatic pressure will go down. Now let's discuss early warning signs of a kick. Okay. The early warning signs are indications which suggest that the well may have taken a kick. Okay. May have taken a kick. It's not a compulsion that well has compulsory taken a kick. Well shayad se kick liya hoga. Okay. So that's what early signs indicates. It does not assure that the well has taken a kick. Okay. Now the driller is required to make a flow check if early signs, warning signs is observed. Okay. Now let's say if the driller observes these 10, one of these 10 signs, at that time he should go for a flow check. Okay. We will discuss flow check in coming up slides. Now we can see that there are 10 early signs been given over here. Okay. There are 10 early signs given. Now let's discuss each and everything, every point in detail. First point is increase in ROP. Okay, increase in ROP. So let's see this particular plot. So this plot is rate of penetration versus depth. Okay. Now you can see that at two points, this is the positive. That means my rate of penetration is increasing. This side is negative side. Okay. So over here I can see that with depth, with increasing depth, ideally my rate of penetration should decrease. Okay, because as we know, with depth, my whatever formation is I am going to encounter, all those would have higher density. Okay, all of them will have higher density, and now to drill through those layers, my rate of penetration will be reduced. Okay, that means to drill those layers, my more amount of energy will be required, and because of that more amount of energy, my rate of penetration will be less. Okay, so as per the trend, if my normal trend is being followed, at that time with increasing depth, my ROP will decrease. You can see, okay, this is the negative side of ROP and this is the positive side. Now with time, my ROP is decreasing. Okay, now let's say if I am facing a sudden increase in rate of penetration. Okay, so this can be the reason of, so this increase in ROP can be one of the early signs. That means if my well has taken a kick, at that time my rate of increase will increase, my rate of penetration will increase suddenly. All right, now there is this term of drilling break, so let me discuss it. Drilling break means it's the first indication of a possible well kick in a drilling break. Okay, that means drilling break is generally observed when there is a permeable section of reservoir rock from which reservoir fluid is entering into my wellbore. Okay, generally when I'm drilling in soft formation, a sand section usually causes a sudden increase in drilling rate. Okay, this increase in drilling rate may vary. Okay, now let's see, let me take another example, you can get it more detail. Let's say I'm drilling over here. I'm just comparing two wells over here. Okay, assume that both the wells are at same depth, and let's say this layer one is a shale layer, and over here there is layer two which is sandstone. Assume this to be a sandstone layer and assume this to be a shale layer. Okay, now both the wells are drilling at the same rate. Each and every parameter like weight on bit, like a torque, hook load, everything, whatever drilling parameters are there, everything is maintained same, is the same for both the wells, and it has also drilled to the same point. The depth is also same for both the wells. I'm just comparing both the wells. Okay, now for the shale layer, okay, when I'm drilling through the shale layer, at that time my ROP would be comparatively low. Okay, because shale will be higher, the density of the shale would be very high, and if I'm drilling through the shale layer, then automatically my ROP will decrease. Now on the other end, now if I'm comparing with a sandstone layer, even in normal case, let's say my well has not even taken a kick, even in normal case, if I'm taking an example of sandstone layer, and if I'm drilling through that sandstone layer, then automatically my ROP would be very high. Okay, because sandstone is high in permeable, and plus the porosity is also very high. Okay, so at that time, even in normal condition, let's say my well has not even taken a kick, even in normal condition, if I'm drilling through a shale layer and if I'm comparing it with a same layer, if I'm comparing at the same depth layer of sandstone, then my sandstone will have a naturally higher ROP. Okay, rate of penetration will be higher in a sandstone reservoir. Got it? Okay. Again, talking about ROP, a gradual increase in ROP may be an indication of an entering abnormal pressure formation. Okay. Now, similarly, weight on bit also changes, which can also be detected by careful observation. Okay. But over here, when ROP increases, so that would be my one of the positive signs, one of the early signs of a kick. Okay. So, increase in ROP is done. Now, second point is increase in torque or drag. Okay. Why this particular thing occurs? Let's see. The larger cuttings caused due to the, when I'm drilling through, my well has taken a kick, okay, and my well is drilling through a reservoir with higher formation pressure. At that time, I can get larger cuttings. Okay, whatever cuttings I am obtaining back, those are larger in size. Okay, so this can lead to piling up of those cuttings and in the wellbore. Okay, in my wellbore, in my bottom hole only,
my larger cutting will get piled up, okay, and because of that piling up of cuttings, this can lead to potential increase in torque or drag. Got it? Okay, now the condition also, whenever I'm drilling, if I'm experiencing drag, that means my at that time I should go for a I should pump a high viscous spill. Okay, high viscous spill means I am pumping a drilling fluid with high viscosity, so that because of this high viscosity I can remove the cuttings whichever is present in the well bore. Okay, it's in hook load. Now displacement of a drilling fluid by influx will result the buoyancy of the drilling fluid getting reduced. Okay, whenever my kick has entered into the well bore, okay, at let's say this is my well bore, okay, and whenever my well bore has taken a kick, whenever my well bore has taken a kick, okay, at that time my overall buoyancy of the drilling fluid gets reduced, okay, and as a result my hook load gets increased. Okay, my hook load gets increased. And why my buoyancy has reduced? Buoyancy has reduced because my overall density of the mud column reduced. Okay, whatever may be the density of the drilling mud, it gets reduced when kick has entered into the well bore. Okay, at that time, because of that particular point, we can say that my I can see a definite increase in the hook load. Okay, got it. Now coming to the fourth point, which is increase in cutting size or shape. So it is generally observed that while normal drilling operations, my cutting sizes are very small in shape, small and almost rounded in shape. Okay, but let's say suddenly my cutting size has become splintery in nature, pointed in nature, and are long in nature. Okay, or has become long. So at that point, it can be one of the potential reason for a early sign of kick. Yeah, that means it can be a potential warning sign for a kick. Now coming to the fifth point, which is change in chemical property or change in mud property. So as the pressure in the formation pressure rises, okay, well, that is as the pressure in the formation pressure formation increases faster than the mud hydrostatic, then more amount of cuttings and cavings will dissolve into the mud and increase the viscosity of the mud. Okay, this can lead to higher changes in mud density trend, and this can also be a potential warning sign for a kick. Okay, so that's change in mud property. Now coming to increase in flow line temperature. Okay, now increase in flow line temperature also indicates increase in formation pressure. Okay, the temperature gradient, as we all know, in abnormal pressure formation is usually higher than the normal formation. So the continuous measurement of the mud temperature at the flow line gives a proper indication of a change in temperature gradient associated with abnormally pressured formation. Okay, the temperature may also sharp increase in transition zones. So let us plot a graph of temperature versus depth. Temperature versus depth. So as we all know, temperature will increase with depth. Okay, now let's say there is a zone, there is this zone where my abnormal pressure is formed. Okay, abnormal pressure is formed, abnormal pressure zone. This is a particular zone where abnormal pressure is found. Then at that time my formation temperature would be rising. Okay, would be having high, my particular that temperature would be very high, and then it will follow the regular trend. Okay, so this particular trend is observed when I am drilling through a normal pressure, when I am drilling through a abnormal pressure, and normally also my temperature will rise with depth, but at abnormal pressure zone my temperature will be rising even more. Got it? Okay, now coming to the next point, which is increase in shale density. As we all know, with depth, my total overburden increases. Okay. Now, because of that density, I am plotting a graph of density versus depth. Now, with depth, my density will increase. Okay. Now, whenever I am observing any sort of transition zone or any sort of abnormal zone, let's say there is an abnormal zone over here, at that point my density will start decreasing, because over here my density will start decreasing and then it will follow the line. This is because my pores is filled with high pressure gas. Okay, that means my particular, that particular zone is having abnormally high pressure, and because of that high pressure, my fluid inside the fluids in the pores try to expand itself, and because of that expansion process, my overall density of the particular rock layer will decrease in the abnormal zone. Got it? Okay. Now, coming to next point, which is decrease in D exponent, we will discuss this D exponent in coming slide. Okay. Now let's move to next slide, which is gas cut mud. Okay, this particular point, which is gas cut mud, as we all know, whatever returns we are getting at the surface, at the flow line, I am continuously recording the gas concentration in the mud. Okay, now if I am observing increase in gas cut, okay, if I am observing there is increase in the gas coming in the form in the mud, so that can also be one of the early warning signs of a kick. Okay, that means, because the gas being coming from the mud, that means it is lightening the fluid column. When my fluid column gets lightened, that means my density of the fluid column decreases, which can lead to the hydrostatic pressure going down. And because of this hydrostatic pressure going down, it may have gone below the formation pressure and would have taken a kick. So that can be a potential warning sign for kick. Okay, which is gas cut mud. Now, coming to the last point, which is increasing chloride content in the mud, is some contamination in my drilling fluid. Okay, this contamination of drilling fluid with considerable volume of saline water from the pores may take place while drilling through high pressure formations. Okay, let's say my salinity has also increased in the drilling mud. My salinity has increased, which has led to the increase in chloride content. So this can be a potential indication that my well is taking some sort of unwanted fluids from the reservoir. As we all know, the reservoir will be saline in nature. The salinity of the fluids, reservoir fluids, will be very high. Whatever water is there in the reservoir, it will be having higher salinity. So if suddenly my chloride content in the mud increases, so it can be a potential early warning sign for a kick. Okay. Again, this increased chloride content of the drilling fluid and its filtrate, a higher chloride trend can warn about increase in pore pressure. Okay, so this point is also important, that sometimes when I am having this higher chloride trend in my drilling mud, so this can also potentially point us that my pore pressure has increased, my formation pressure is increased. So we need to take care that, and we need to take care and we need to do further action. Okay, now let's discuss about D exponent. Now, this D exponent, this is a very important term. Very important term. D exponent basically is a extrapolation of drilling parameters to get a trend while drilling into overpressurized zone. Okay. Now, the D exponent can be utilized to detect the transition from normal pressure regime to abnormal formation pressure. Okay. While drilling, if the change of trend is observed, rig supervisors may be cautious about this situation, because this is one of the possible well control indications, or this is a potential early warning sign that my well has taken a kick. Okay. Now, normal trend of D exponent will be increase. Okay. Normally with depth, my D exponent increases, but if I am now encountering some overpressurized zone, at that time my D exponent will decrease. Okay. Now, this is the formula. This is the formula of D exponent, where D is equal to log R upon 60 N divided by log log 12 into weight on weight divided by 1000 of d. So let's see over here, where d is my d exponent, r is my rate of penetration in feet per hour. It's feet per hour, r means rate of penetration, n is my rotary speed in rpm, rotation per minute, w is my weight on weight in kilopounds. Okay, it is in KLBS, it is in kilopounds, and my d is bit size in inches. Okay, now the original d exponent is good for constant mud weight, but in reality several drilling operations drill with various mud weights in a hole due to weight up. As we all know, if I'm drilling deeper, then I will use a different mud, a mud with higher density. Okay, so this particular d exponent is assumed, whenever I am calculating d exponent, then it is assumed to have constant mud weight throughout the well, but it is not true. So we need some corrected exponent, some corrected d exponent, so that we can also take into consideration the mud weight parameter, the change in mud weight parameter. Okay, so for doing that, we are introducing this mud weight corrected d exponent. So this is the formula. Again, this is almost similar to d. So this is basically d exponent into mud weight 1 divided by mud weight 2, where mud weight 1 is the initial mud weight in pound per gallon, and divided by actual mud weight, which is divided by the current mud weight in the wellbore. Got it? So this is how you calculate corrected d exponent. Now let's discuss positive signs of kick. Okay. Now positive signs of kick are different from the early warning signs. They indicate confirmly that the kick has already been taken into the wellbore, and once you have these four positive signs of kick, and if at all I am experiencing one of these parameters, then it is confirmed my well has taken a kick, and now I should not go for a flow check. You don't require flow check. In flow check, what we do is that we basically shut my mud pump. Okay, we switch off the mud pump, and we see whether my well is flowing or not. So that is flow check. Okay, now if any positive sign of kick is observed by the driller, you should immediately shut the well as per the company's shut-in policy. Okay, again, shut-in, we can have a hard shut-in or a soft shut-in depending on the company's policy. Okay. Now let's discuss these four points. Now let's say first point is increase in return flow. Okay, when the mud pumps are on, at that time if I am getting an increased return flow, so that is one of the positive sign of a kick. Okay, so after the early warning signs, the first positive kick sign is increase in the flow rate at the flow line with the pumps on. So increase in flow rate indicates entrance of any fluid into the wellbore. Got it? It is very obvious. Second point is flow from well when the pumps are off. Okay, so second point is when the flow check is a reliable method. Again, flow check is a reliable method of checking for a well kick by stopping the pump. Okay, if the well does not flow when the pump is shut off and remains static throughout for, let's say, 2 to 3 minutes, then we can say that my well is not taken a kick. But now, even after keeping my pumps off, if I'm getting returns in my flow line, that means confirm I can say that well has taken a kick, and it is one of the positive sign of a kick. Got it? Okay. Third point is increase in pit volume. Now an increase in pit volume is obvious, and it is a positive indication of well, or positive indication of flow into the well bore. Okay. If an increase in pit volume is observed, shut off the pump and make a flow check which confirms the kick is entering. Again, the same thing. If I am observing some sort of increase in pit volume, then I should go for a flow check. Flow check means I am switching off my mud pump and I am seeing whether my well has taken a kick. And if it starts to flow, and if it further increases the pit volume, that means you should now go for secondary well control. Okay. Coming to the fourth point, which is decreasing pump pressure and increasing pump stroke. Okay, now let's say there is a case where my well has taken a kick. Okay, now when the well has taken a kick, at that time it is confirmed that my well has gone underbalanced. That means I have lost my overbalance condition, I have lost my primary well control, and my well has gone underbalanced. Okay, now at that point, okay, my circulating pressure, whatever be my circulating pressure, since my wellbore has taken a lighter fluid inside it, my pump pressure will reduce. Okay, since because of this reduced pump pressure, okay, my pump speed increases or my pump stroke increases to compensate that reduce in pump pressure. Got it? Again, this is a very obvious thing. When my pump pressure goes down, to compensate that, my pump stroke will get increased. Got it? Okay. Now let's discuss inflex types and its behavior. Now, whenever my kick fluid weighs less than 3 pounds per gallon, then it is definitely a gas. My well has taken a, if my kick has density less than 3 pounds per gallon, that means it is a gas kick. If the kick density lies between 3 to 9 pounds per gallon, then it is a mixture of oil and gas. And if my kick is density of kick is more than 9, or if it lies between 9 to 10, then it is a salt water kick. Got it? Okay. Now let's discuss gas influx behavior in an open well. This is also termed as gas migration theory. We will directly use this migration theory, gas migration theory, when we are discussing well killing method. We will directly use this particular concept where I will be discussing gas influx behavior in an open well in case 1 and in closed well in coming up slide. Okay. Now let's see in an open well, how does the gas influx behavior affects. Now in an open well, gas migration, the influx starts migrating upwards as it enters the well bore. Okay. Now let's say my well bore has taken a gas kick over here. Okay. And since my well is open, again the gas density being lighter in nature, so by virtue of this density difference, this gas kick will move automatically upwards. Okay, see, my well is moving this kick is moving automatically upwards. Now there is volumetric expansion of the gas as the gas travels upwards. Since I have not closed the well, since my well is completely open from the top, and there is no back pressure given, so because of that, my gas kick is expanding by itself. Okay, by itself only, by virtue of density difference, it is moving up. And since I have not given any sort of back pressure by closing the well, my gas kick is now getting expanded by itself. Got it? Okay. The effect of gas migration in an open hole. Let's see the effects. My bottom hole pressure reduces. See, as we can see, my equivalent mud weight. So this is the point. Let's say my gas kick is at this particular depth. So at that time, my bottom hole pressure was 50-100. Now, slowly and steadily, as my gas kick is going up and as it is getting expanded, you can see my bottom hole pressure is getting reduced, and correspondingly, my equivalent mud weight is also getting reduced. Again, the reason is as my gas kick is going upwards, it is lightening my density of the fluid column. So as a result, my bottom hole pressure is getting reduced. Okay, and you can also see that as the gas kick is going up, you can see it the volume was 1 barrel at this particular depth. Now at this depth, it has now been expanded to 2 barrel. As it moves up, 4 barrel, 8 barrel, 16 barrel. So that is, as it is going up, since I am not giving any sort of back pressure from outside and my well is in open condition, my gas kick is getting expanded. So first point is bottom hole pressure reduces. We have seen that. Second is gas bubble pressure also reduces, because gas pressure, whatever pressure I am having in this gas, it is also getting reduced because my gas, as it travels upwards, it is getting expanded. Because of that expansion, my gas bubble pressure is also reducing. Next point is pressure below the bubble reduces. Okay, whatever pressure is there below this bubble, it also reduces, and pressure above the bubble remains constant. Whatever fluid is above this bubble, the pressure above this, what the fluid column above this, will have constant pressure. Okay, below the bubble you can observe some decrease in pressure of the fluid column, but above the bubble, since my bubble has not aerated the above portion, So that portion will have the same pressure. The fluid will have the same pressure, but below that particular point, since my gas has traveled till, let's say this is the position of gas kick as of now, and since it has traveled from this point to this point, while traveling my gas kick has made the fluid column lighter. Okay, so these are the four points that we need to take into consideration when we are discussing about a gas influx behavior in an open well. Now let's see how the gas influx changes in a, what would be my behavior in closed well. So when the well is closed, there is no room for expansion of gas influx. So this will carry its original pressure with it while migrating up the wellbore. Again, the gas will migrate upwards by virtue of density difference. So it will obviously go upwards like the case of open well, but since I have closed the well, since my well is shut, my pressure, my gas kick is not getting expanded. There is no provision for the gas kick to expand itself. Okay. Now, as a result, there will be a pressure rise on both SICP and SIDPP. Now, in a closed well, when the well has taken a gas kick, at that time, as the gas kick goes upward, that is towards the surface, both my shut-in drill pipe pressure and my shut-in casing pressure will rise. Okay. Now, let's see the effect of gas migration in a closed well. Gas influx pressure remains same. See, whatever pressure my gas, see, let's say the influx pressure at this particular point was 5700. That means if my gas kick has this particular pressure, even if it move upwards, it will carry that same 5700 pressure throughout. Okay, since it is carrying this pressure upwards, my SIDPP and SICP is continuously increasing. Got it? Now, you can also see that my bottom hole pressure increases. See, as my gas kick is going up, my bottom hole pressure is getting increased. Why? Because my shut-in casing pressure and my shut-in drill pipe pressure both is getting increased as my gas is migrating upwards. Okay, and the last point is pressure at any point below or above, the pressure increases. Let's take an example of a gas kick at this point in a closed well. Now, the pressure below this fluid column and the pressure above this fluid column, both the pressure of the fluid column will be increasing, will have an increasing trend. Got it? Okay. Now, let's discuss what would be the behavior of different types of influx. Okay. Now let's say my well has taken a gas kick. Now, as we all know, gas is a high compressible fluid. If not allowed to expand, will bring the formation pressure on the top of wellbore by percolation. Again, as I mentioned, in closed well condition where my gas is migrating, if I am not allowing the gas kick to expand, then it will take that particular pressure, whatever pressure it was having at the bottommost part, it will take that pressure to the surface, which is very hazardous to the personnel working on the drill floor. Okay, it is easy to detect while using WBM. If I am using a water based mud, then the gas kick is easy to be recognized, but whenever I am going for a oil based mud, it is difficult to identify whether my well has taken a kick or not. Reason is gas gets dissolved in the oil used in oil based mud. Okay, so this is the behavior of a gas influx. Now coming to behavior of a oil influx. Oil does not expand. Okay, if my well has taken oil influx, then there will be no expansion of oil. It again travels up the annulus due to density difference. Even we have discussed in gas kick also, the reason why it is traveling upwards is by the virtue of density difference. Oil will also move upwards because of density difference. It is difficult to detect when using OBM. Let's say if I am drilling with a OBM mud, at that time oil get dissolved in OBM. Okay, so I should rather, if I am having a well water based mud, then it would be comparatively easy to detect oil influx in whether my well has taken an oil influx or not. Okay, so WBM is generally preferred when we are expecting some sort of a oil influx kick. So in this point, what I've did is that I have made a like to like comparison of a WBM and oil based mud. Okay, So I'm just comparing what would be my effect if my well has taken a kick in one case where in case one where I am using WBM mud as my drilling fluid, and in case two I am using OBM mud as my drilling fluid. Now in WBM mud, if my well has taken a gas kick, then expansion of gas will occur. In OBM mud, there won't be no expansion of gas, but the gas will get dissolved in OBM mud. The pit gain will be more. Because of this expansion of gas, whatever volume I am obtaining in my pit, the gain would be more. And over here in this case, my pit gain is less. Coming to this point, SICP, if I'm just comparing, just for an example, if I'm comparing SICP, that is the pressure recorded at casing side, certain casing pressure, so that would be more for a W-based mud, water-based mud, as compared to that of a oil-based mud, which will be having SICP of 200 PSI. It's just, I'm just making a like-to-like comparison, okay? Now, coming to next point, reduction in bottom hole pressure due to expansion of gas. Again, due to reduction of, because of the my gas being getting expanded, my bottom hole pressure will reduce more as compared to that of a oil-based mud. If my well has a gas kick, then there will be reduction, but as compared to a water-based mud, in oil-based mud, my reduction in bottom hole pressure would be less. Now, let's compare a flow check. Okay, if I'm going for a flow check in the water-based mud, and my mud has taken a gas kick, at that time, within 2 to 3 minutes, I can detect whether my well has taken a kick. Okay, within 2 to 3 minutes, my detection is done. But in case of an oil-based mud, I have to give flow check of around 15 to 30 minutes because the detection of gas is difficult. Okay, now as per API specification, in oil-based mud, even with a negative flow check, don't drill further. For an oil-based mud, close the BOP and complete the bottoms up. Okay, if I am experiencing any sort of early warning signs, and even with a negative flow check, what I will do is I will now close my BOP and complete the bottoms up. I will completely try to do a bottoms up with the help of drilling mud, and pit gain margin should be kept less. This point means if my pit gain is occurring, even a small pit gain is occurring, okay, then we can say that my well has taken a gas kick in case of oil-based mud. Okay, discuss for HPST well. For HPST well, the liquid influx may get converted into gas influx. Why? Because there is my reduction in pressure and temperature. Let's say I have taken a kick from this particular depth. Let's say this is my drill string and this is my bit. If I have taken a kick from this particular depth, and this particular depth is having high pressure and temperature, as this kick travels upwards, my pressure and temperature will go down, obviously. Okay, so this may lead to convert this can potentially convert my liquid influx into a gas influx. Okay, now this influx on conversion to gas will move faster and will lead to uncontrollable pressure. Got it? So this is the case for an HPST well.